Hi there, it's Jeremy from Precision Nutrition here. The internet is a wreck with dietary debates that are meant to help and be well-meaning, but they often leave people feeling more confused and more divided. At Precision Nutrition, we like to think of ourselves as dietary agnostics, meaning we take what is best from all dietary research and try and leave the nonsense to the side. Today, we're going to look at 5 evidence-based universal principles of nutrition that we feel that can help almost anyone achieve a leaner body, live healthier, and live in a way that feels more sustainable to them. At the end of this video, we have one bonus principle that we think would be a game changer for some folks. Okay, let's hop into that hit list. Principle number one, the energy you intake should be balanced with the energy you expend. Weight maintenance, weight loss, and weight gain all come down to one key function. Energy in refers to the calories that you intake through food and drink. Energy out refers to the energy you expend through purposeful movement, as well as the functions that your body performs just to keep you alive and healthy. When the energy that you intake is the same as the energy you burn, your body maintains its mass. When you take in more energy than you burn, your body will gain mass. And when you burn more energy than your body intakes, you'll lose mass. Of course, there's many factors that can affect how many calories your body intakes, including your appetite, energy expenditure, and energy availability, what's around you. Similarly, there are many factors that can affect your energy output, including mindful movement and the type of work that you do. However, without a doubt, this equation holds true. In fact, it's a law of thermodynamics. If you want to change your body mass, you need to manipulate either how much energy you expend or how much energy you intake. If you want to maintain your weight, well, basically keep doing what you're doing. If you're looking to lose weight, you will probably want to eat a little bit less, particularly calorie-dense processed foods, and move a little bit more. And of course, if you're looking to gain weight, you'll want to eat a little bit more, specifically high quality proteins, minimally processed carbs, and healthy fats. In addition to training hard, but making sure to recover in between your sessions. Principle number two, get enough protein. Why? Two reasons. Reason number one, protein helps to build and maintain more muscle mass, preserve bone health, and generally keep us healthier. You'll want to try and distribute your protein intake evenly throughout the day, aiming for 1.6 to 2.2 grams per kilogram of body weight. Reason number two, protein helps you eat less without feeling so hungry. Protein helps you feel full for longer and stimulates appetite regulating hormones in the gut. When you eat more protein, you tend to eat less. So whether you're trying to gain more lean mass or lose weight, protein can definitely help. Principle number three, build your diet around minimally processed foods. Humans are generally healthier when we eat fewer refined foods and more whole foods. This is probably because the more processed that food is, the more likely it has lost nutritional value, such as fiber, essential fatty acids, vitamins, minerals, and other compounds found in plant and animal foods. And it is likely that it has also gained some sugars, additives, preservatives, fillers, and other unhealthy things along the way. With processed foods, it's the opposite. You can still consume a lot of calories, but be missing out on vital nutrients. Here's an example. A less processed steak dinner with potato will have about 350 calories less than a highly processed dinner of burgers and fries. Not to mention the burger and fries having much more sodium and the steak and potatoes being higher in fiber, protein, and other nutrients. And I'd argue that choosing the steak and potato dinner is just as satisfying as the burger and fries. But while choosing minimally processed foods, remember, it doesn't have to be an all or nothing when pursuing health. Rather than separating foods into whole and non-whole categories, imagine you see these things on a spectrum. As you can see from the graphic, as foods become more processed, they tend to lose their nutritional power. So whenever you can, just choose foods that are slightly less processed. These small choices add up over time. And no, you don't have to totally give up your love of nachos. Principle number four, make friends with fruits and vegetables. Fruits and vegetables are loaded with vitamins, minerals, phytonutrients, and antioxidants. And a huge body of evidence collected over the past 20 years shows without a doubt that consuming more fruits and vegetables can be helpful for preventing a host of diseases, including cancer, diabetes, and heart disease. In addition, fruits and vegetables tend to be high volume but low calorie, meaning they take up a lot of space within your stomach, meaning you can eat more, feel full, without adding a lot of calories to your overall diet. However, as you can see, fruits and vegetables do not make up a big proportion of the average American diet. If getting 5 to 10 servings of fruits and vegetables feels unrealistic to you, start by adding 1 or 2 to your day and take it from there. Once you get comfortable and consistent with that, try adding another 1 or 2 servings. Remember, it's not about doing this perfectly. Think of it this way. Each time you add a fruit or vegetable to your diet, it's a little high five to your health, and it helps to reduce your risk of chronic disease. Principle number 5, prioritize good sleep. This isn't surprising, but it's often overlooked. When you get good quality sleep, maintaining your health habits and basically doing everything gets a little bit easier. There's a good reason for that. If you sleep 5 or 6 hours, but your body needs closer to 7 or 8, you're keeping your body in a chronically sleep-deprived state. This makes it harder for your body to regulate key appetite-controlling hormones. Ghrelin levels rise, triggering hunger. Leptin levels fall, making it harder to feel full. And endocannabinoid levels increase, making food seem more pleasurable than it actually is. You're also tired, so you exercise less and move less. In addition, this gives you more time to be awake, which means that you're more likely to raid the fridge. Bottom line, sleep-deprived people tend to eat, on average, an extra 300 calories. They also tend to suffer from depression and anxiety at higher levels and have a harder time regulating their emotions. We can't control all aspects of good sleep, but we can set up conditions that make good sleep much more likely. Things that can help are waking up and going to sleep at a consistent time, ensuring that caffeine use is used primarily during the morning, avoiding alcohol before we go to bed, and also limiting screens and electronics time as we approach bedtime. Instead, think of substituting activities that promote restfulness, such as reading, light stretching, yoga, and other relaxing activities. And lastly, that bonus principle that we promised, internal regulation. This one can be a game changer for many people. Calorie counting and other external ways of regulating your intake can be super useful, but there's a downside. When we rely heavily on external methods to regulate our intake, it is often that we forget how to use our own internal cues and tell us when to stop eating. We've learned from coaching over 100,000 clients that most folks don't need strict calorie control methods to reach their goals anyway. There are a few exceptions, but most people can make phenomenal progress by using this skill of internal regulation, where you begin to listen to and learn from your internal cues to tell you when to stop and start eating. Research is starting to back up our clinical findings as well, showing that when people use internal regulation, they are more likely to make choices that favor less processed foods. How do you do it? Well, the quick version is you learn to pay attention to sensations before, during, and after your meals. You'll pay particular attention to sensations of hunger, satisfaction, and fullness. This is much easier to do when paired with slow eating, putting down your fork in between bites and minimizing distractions. This may look like putting away your phone, turning off your TV, or maybe turning off this video. It's okay, we're done anyway. Thanks for watching. And if you'd like to learn more about this topic, check out the video description for a link to the article. And of course, if you like this video, please give us a comment, like, and subscribe. That is a struggle now. Try and food, try and choose. Slide, end up over time. Sorry. Much more like, dang it. Okay. Why two more? Why just finish where you're good?